Steven Joyce was the National Party's campaign manager for no fewer than five elections. For four of those, National won more votes than any other party. Joyce earned a reputation as being adept as a minister at getting big changes through the machinery of government. Now, with 2 months until the 2023 general election, Steven Joyce has published his memoir on the record. Kia ora, good morning.
Morning. How are you, Jack?
Very well, thanks. It's the first time you've seen the book.
It is. It's the first time I've seen an actual physical copy of it.
Yeah. Well, I want to dive into your own memories and political history in a moment.
Sure.
But given tomorrow is 2 months until polling day, let's start with the current election. From your experience as National's campaign manager, what is your assessment of the campaigns as they stand?
Well, I think it's probably wider open than it was for many, probably for all of my five campaigns. I mean, the distinction here this time is that the two major parties look like getting a smaller proportion of the vote than they have in many elections, as two, which brings the smaller party significantly into play. You've got ACT and Green around that 10% mark, which means whatever government you get after the election is going to be quite driven by the smaller partner. You've got old Winston, you know, on manoeuvres, as I say in the book, once again. And he tends to, as you can see in the polls, he tends to do well when at least one of the other parties is weak. So I'd say it's fairly wide open, but I think on balance with the direction of travel, and people talk a lot about that right direction, wrong direction indicator that all the polls focus on, but I do think that makes it an uphill battle for the incumbent to win. It's very wrong direction at the moment. The public are looking for change, and the question is, will they press the button? And I think it's increasingly likely, not guaranteed by any manner of means, because there's a lot to happen between now and the election day, but increasingly likely that they might press that button.
If you look at the big donations that have come in so far, so donations that are more than $20,000, National, ACT and the Greens have all brought in more money than Labor.
Yeah.
How is that likely to affect things over the next 2 months?
Not hugely, because ironically, money only enables campaigning to some degree. It doesn't change the nature of campaigns, despite what some people think. You need to have funding to campaign. But you also have the government funding through for TV ads and all those sorts of things. And some ways these days, the ubiquity of social media means you can do a whole lot of stuff that is effectively free. And so I don't think it'll have a massive impact, but it's probably a bit of a referendum on the relative popularity of the parties with their bases. I think Labor, with the sort of move from Jacinda Ardern to Chris Hipkins and the junking of policies and the new directions and all this sort of stuff, that's probably confused the Labor base and the Labor supporters. The Greens know where they want to be, and their big supporters are right behind them. National and ACT supporters obviously want change.
You have the unique perspective from having been at the cabinet table, having been one of John Key's most trusted ministers, but also having a career in media and in marketing. From the outside, what would you say are the biggest differences between John Key and Christopher Luxon?
Oh, I hadn't thought about that. Look, I think that it's hard to spot the difference and spot the similarity. I mean, people often talk about Christopher Luxon, is he the next John Key or is he not? It's fun to have that conversation, but actually it doesn't mean anything.
And what do you say when people ask you that?
Exactly that. I said it's a bit irrelevant. I think Chris Luxon's his own person. I think probably most importantly that if he gets the job, he'll be facing with entirely different challenges that John Key had. Every government's determined by events. The events that determine the next government haven't happened yet. So I think he's very capable, very organised. And probably one similarity with John would be he tends to lead a team but let the team do its job. And I was very privileged to be in a government, which isn't necessarily common, where you're trusted to do a job. And sure, you've got to do it, but you don't get sort of micromanaged by the leader.
Yeah.
And that has happened plenty of times.
So your first experience as National Party's campaign manager was 2005,
yes,
which was arguably the most controversial of the campaigns you oversaw. So there is one memory that stuck out for me from that campaign, and I think we've got some pictures of it here. The Iwi versus Kiwi billboards. Upon reflection, do you think those were good for New Zealand?
Well, I don't think they on their own represent much, except they are just a depiction and illustration of what was going on at the time. Mm. I don't think racial divisiveness works for New Zealand.
Do you think that was racially divisive?
No, I think it reflected, I don't know, there's plenty of people with different views, and many people took it a different way to what I took it when I saw it, which was looking at one as a subset of the whole rather than you know, you have one or the other.
So what do you mean by that?
Well, that Kiwis is everybody, and by incorporating the word iwi and the word Kiwi, it was supposed to be a clever play on words, which sort of got lost a little bit in the debate. But I think the bigger question is, why was 2005 like that? Mm. And I think, unfortunately, it's playing out a bit again this year. It's different, and you know, there won't be any of those billboards and Shaw and all that sort of stuff. But unfortunately, we've had two governments now who have probably got ahead of a significant proportion of the population in their approach to race relations. And we spent, you know, with the likes of Chris Finlayson, Bill English, Tariana Turia, Peter Sharples, John Key, spent a lot of time sort of managing New Zealand's race relations into a much happier place. And unfortunately, I think that's going to be the lot of the next government as well, because we've had a very assertive Māori caucus in the Labour Party that wants this stuff and that stuff and that stuff, and they've got ahead of the country. And that happened in 05, and it's happening again now.
In what ways have they got ahead of the country?
Well, because it's a focus on identity politics, and it's broader than just ethnic issues. And I think the trouble with identity politics is that it always puts people on the outside base that they aren't that identity. You know, people don't respond well to that. Mm. So I think, you know, we do need to get into a position, and this will be a challenge for the next government, should one be elected, a new government, will be, how do you draw everybody back together again and get them rowing in the same wokka?
Would a referendum on the principles of Te Tiriti o Waitangi, or the Treaty of Waitangi, be good for New Zealand?
I'm not sure about that, but I'm also not going to do a big critique on the various parties' policies. Mm. But I think it's going to take people want to be feeling that they're all in it together. And yes, some people need help, but it's generally not on. It's not helpful to do it on various aspects of their identity. It's better to help people that need help.
I suppose the danger is, looking at something like the iwi versus Kiwi thing, some people would say that actually intensified divides, especially off the back of the audio with speech, of course.
Well, it was a thing of its time, and you know, we're nearly 20 years ago now. Mm. The Ariwa speech, of course, the big irony of that, people sort of, it was like a masterful sort of stroke. As I write in the book, everybody was surprised about the reaction to that speech, including Don Brash. And you know, people say, oh, that was the turning point, the masterstroke or whatever, and you either agree with it or you disagree with it. But actually, it was just a speech. Mm. and the public reaction to it was what drove it.
Infrastructure is a massive challenge facing New Zealand. And in your book, you reflect on the rollout of ultra-fast broadband, which I think, regardless of people's political stripes, many people would consider is one of, if not the most successful rollout of a big infrastructure project in New Zealand's recent history, at the very least. What are the lessons that we should apply from the rollout of that project to other big infrastructure projects in New Zealand?
Well, it's a danger to take a huge amount out of it, because it was, again, a creature of its moment. But I think firstly is try and draw in everybody that actually can make a contribution. That's the private sector as well as the public sector. That was a very much private sector driven project. It was controlled and funded in part by the public sector, but it was, the execution of it was very much, the chorus and all that sort of thing was that actually did it were private sector players. The contrast with Australia, I think, is very relevant. Australia, they tried to They tried to bully Telstra into selling the business, and eventually they did, but for a ridiculous price. Mm. And they nationalised it effectively, the broadband rollout, and it was rubbish after that.
Mm.
And I think it's trying to find the shortest path to success, keeping clarity about what success looks like. Because the thing about politics is everybody's got a view, right? And it's always a different view. So you have to sort of get, okay, what were we thinking at the start? Why do we come to do this? And no, yes, it may be important to have international pipelines, or it may be important to have backhaul, but actually the goal here is this, and this is what we need to do. So keep coming back to it, and you know, hire really good people and let them do their jobs.
But as a minister, are there lessons that we can take for that for other projects? For example, and I should say, I know you are not a supporter of light rail, for example.
Well, apparently.
But let's just for a thought experiment for a moment.
Yeah.
If you were the minister in charge of delivering light rail, what would you have done differently to further progress that project in the last 6 years?
Oh, well, I think you have to tailor it to what it is that you're trying to do, which comes back to that point, right? Mm. What are you actually trying to achieve? And if it is access to, you know, those inner western suburbs of Auckland from the CBD, well, let's focus on that. Let's not try and turn it into the airport thing or back from the airport thing or whatever. You know, it's morphed around a lot. Secondly, what are you actually trying to achieve? What are you, and is this the best way of doing it? And I think that's a question, but let's assume then, to your point, that it was. Then you really have to say, well, what's the mechanism by which we're going to achieve it? And yeah, it was just all a bit random. I don't know whether you remember the sort of the idea that the super fund would do it. And they didn't trust NZTA, Waka Kotahi, to do it. They allowed this parallel process. Imagine that. So you're there, you're the agency charged with leading a procurement for it. And meanwhile, another arm of government is in talking to a different set of ministers saying, hey, we'll run it. And the minister's saying, yeah, that could be a good idea. And you're like, what am I doing here? And so the whole thing, there was no shape to it. And so if you were going to do it, then let's, for goodness sake, agree what it's trying to achieve, set some parameters around it, and then hire some good people and let them get on with it. Make it contestable, absolutely. It's got to be contestable. But you can't have a contestable process if a construction company doesn't even know whether to go to the super fund or to Waka Kotahi to have the conversation. That's nuts.
You love roads in the right place.
They tend to work, as a general rule.
You were behind the roads of national significance, and you were involved in the early stages of Transmission Gully.
Yes.
Of course, that had a benefit-cost ratio of 0.6 at its original
costing. On its own, yeah.
Yeah, which then blew out. The costing blew out. It went over time.
Well, ironically, the costing that we had for it was always expected to be around 1.1, 1.2 billion. It came back with the quotes and the process that went through and came to less than a billion, I think, was the agreed price, which then, as you say, blew out.
The review from the Infrastructure Commission was pretty scathing when it was released in 2021. But when you look at the road as it stands now, and you reflect on the whole process, the ups and downs, do you think it represents good value?
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
I think it is huge value, both for the transport benefits, the safety benefits, but the bit that we don't like to talk about, which is also the Wellington resilience bit. We all hope that we don't get the big earthquake that everybody tells us we're going to get in Wellington. But that was one of the things that swung it for me. And I remember the head of DPMZ at the time, Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet, Martin Weavers, saying he supported this to me, not because of all the other stuff, but because his obsession was what happens to Wellington if there's a big quake. And if you look at that sort of the two other exits out of Wellington, one is along the bottom of the cliff there at Pukerua Bay, and the other one's, you know, over the Rumataka Hills.
Yeah. And both fairly precarious.
Well, both would be gone.
Yeah.
They would both be gone. In fact, the general civil defence planning for the city is that it's cut off for weeks if something like that happens. So he thought, I think that alone is one reason to do it. But it's hugely important. And we have, you know, I write in the book about how we're sort of courageous to build the capital city on the sort of outcrop of rock at the bottom of an island, but we've done it. And it needs to be connected to the rest of the country.
Politics is all about timing, and your time as Prime Minister never came. How do you feel about that?
Relaxed.
Would you have liked to be Prime Minister?
No. I mean, look, I used to say to John, you've got to sit and listen to a lot of things. I mean, Prime Ministers go around sitting and listening and opening stuff and way more than ministers do.
Yeah.
And I thought it was quite good that he did all that. And, yeah. And there were one or two others of us that got to do, you know, roll our sleeves up and get stuff done.
Yeah.
So
was that the benefit of not standing in lectures as well?
Well, I say in the book, I was asked to stand at North Shore, and I would have quite liked it. But look, I was in a very privileged position. Mm. I was brought in, asked to do a job, and I was there in Parliament for 9.5 years. I've met MPs who have been in Parliament for 12 or 15 years and never been a minister. Mm. So it was a very privileged position to be in, and I hope I did it well, and I hope I, you know, gave the public enough of a return from that.
I've got to give you a hard time about one thing.
Sure.
Reporting from RNZ shows that over the last 3 years, you've received close to $1 million in consulting fees from Massey University. At the same,
not Massey University.
Actually. Oh, sorry. From universities. At the same time, you've publicly criticised the Labor government for not giving universities enough money. Is that an ethical position to hold while
Yeah, I think so. I know the university sector very well. In terms of the work I did, at the end of the day, the university can establish the value that I gave them, and they're very, very positive about that. And it was a number of projects that I executed for them, and that particular university is, I think, in a very strong position at the moment relative to the others. None of them are in a brilliant position. I do think that the government ignored what was coming for the university sector for some time in terms of the drop of the pipeline of international students and then the drop in the domestic students. And now they're playing catch up, and as a result, the university sector has been damaged. I took my position as somebody who's helped them stay afloat with a range of projects. As I think the two can work together.
Mm. There was an infamous moment that many of our viewers, I'm sure, will remember, and I'm sure you're never allowed to forget. At Waitangi, a protester threw a certain projectile in your direction.
That's
fair
right.
to say that. You took the whole thing on the chin?
Literally.
In every sense? Yeah. Does any part of you resent Dildo Gate?
No. And there's no point, because it happened. I do find it amusing when people on social media sort of like throw it at me as if it's a blight on my copybook. And I was like, well, I don't think I threw it. Mm. You know, I happened to be the politician standing there. You know, it was meant for John Key, of course. That was the plan. So I've had him on over the years that I took one for the team, so to speak. Look, it's just something that happened. And you know, and some of the reaction to it was very funny. I mean, I think the John Oliver stuff was, you know, was priceless, really. And look, you just, you know, stuff happens. I mean, nobody got hurt.
Mm. Should Christopher Luxon rule out working with Winston Peters?
That's for him to suss out. So I don't think it would be any helpful.
In the book, you talk quite... it's very interesting that the details that you share around the coalition negotiations in 2017, which you were...
What was the impression you got from those?
The impression that I got was that you never felt like Winston Peters gave National a chance.
I actually was more positive than that, but there were certainly some that didn't think... You know, that thought it was all for show, really. Look, I think the thing is that he's out for number one, and that's fine. But you've got to take a grain of salt. Mm. Anything he says ahead of an election compared to afterwards, and if people want to vote for him after that, well, then that's fine. But I think 2017 showed that. I think previously he'd always said, yeah, he'd prefer to go with the largest party, and I think that's a healthier position to take. And look, you know, 2017 happened, and. They went with the second largest party, which was the first time, I think, since 1911. And you can do that because it's in the rules. That's doable. I wouldn't like to see it happen too many times, though, because then the whole political system comes into question again. Because ultimately, political systems are driven by the people that, you know, vote. Mm. And if they think that their preferences are being frustrated, then, as I say, I don't think that came out of 17. But if it happened again quite soon after, then I think it would be... people would start to be questioning the system again.
What was the upside to John Key's decision to rule out working with Winston Peters?
Well, we did that a couple of times. Mm. And the upside was, in those instances, was making it clear that, what the shape of a new government might look like. Mm. We were in a stronger position, though, to be fair. In both cases. And so it's a different decision this time. Mm. for the current team. But yeah, personally, Winston is a likable rogue, but I wouldn't like to back any of my future in any sense on Winston's say-so. I just wouldn't do it.
would a National Act New Zealand First government, theoretically, would that survive?
Oh, I'm sure it would. Would it be strong government? Maybe not. Look, people have a funny way, and I think there's a limit to how much you can use history to guide the future. Some of it is important, but ultimately, whatever happens after the election will happen. Mm. There will be a government. It will run. With the greatest respect to the current one, they haven't set the bar very high. So we'll just have to see what happens.